Corsair Vengeance RGB DDR4 memory modules feature customizable multicolor lighting and are designed for overclocking with XMP 2.0 support. Give your build a unique look with vibrant RGB LED memory by Corsair. Click the link in the description for more information.
Excellent!
What's up, guys? Welcome back to Paul's Hardware. Today I'm continuing my monthly build series. This is my third installation of the April build of the month, which is a $1,000 Ryzen 5 based system with an R5 1600 and a GTX 1070 in there. I built this just a couple weeks ago, so check out that video if you want to see a little bit more about the build process itself, as well as some of my notes on the assembling and using the case and that kind of thing. So today's video is going to be the testing and benchmarking of this $1,000 system. And actually, when I built it a couple weeks ago, I actually made it a little bit more expensive than $1,000. I did the $1,050 version, which included the 1600X CPU, which required an aftermarket cooler in the Cooler Master Air 4 Pro that I put in there. Now, what I did was I decided I wanted this to be a sub $1,000 build. And thankfully, if you check out the links to the PC part picker list that I have in the description, you'll notice that some prices have fluctuated. In fact, the GTX 1070 price you can get for $335 to $340. So this system right now, at least not with this exact GPU, but the EVGA version of it, you can get for less than $1,000. You also get the Wraith cooler, the Wraith Spire cooler that's in there, which means you don't need to pay extra for an aftermarket cooler. And even though this cooler isn't like top of the line or anything like that, it's getting the job done. It's not terribly loud, and I was able to overclock with it too. Apart from that CPU and cooler though, this build features the ASUS Prime B350 Plus motherboard, full-size ATX motherboard with the B350 chipset. The graphics card is a GTX 1070, and I basically advised you to choose whatever most inexpensive GTX 1070 you can find. This one happens to be MSI's Gaming X version of the GTX 1070. For memory, I have two sticks of Corsair DDR4 3000 speed memory, 8 gigs each, giving me 16 gigs total. I am running it at 2933 with very slightly loosened up timings. The case, of course, is the NZXT S340 in the black and red trim. The power supply is the Cooler Master V650. And finally, for an SSD, I've actually swapped in a Seagate 600 series SSD. That's a 480 gig model right there. Now, for setup here, I first went and updated the motherboard's UEFI, or BIOS, because that's very important. New ones are coming out. They introduce greater RAM stability, as well as potentially greater stability and compatibility with different hardware you might plug into a B350 chipset motherboard. Version I'm using is 0609. And then, of course, I went and overclocked everything. CPU and memory was overclocked using my Ryzen 5 overclocking methodology that I just did a video on a couple days ago. You can check that out via the link up in the corner. And then I overclocked the graphics card with the MSI Afterburner utility. Of course, I also went in and updated all of the Windows 10 drivers. I got the latest drivers from NVIDIA, which is 381.89, and then I'm using monitoring utilities, CPU-Z, GPU-Z, hardware monitor, and of course MSI Afterburner. So from there, I went in to start doing some tests, but what I didn't realize was that my overclock wasn't stable. I thought it was stable, and then I was running 3DMark, and I was basically crashing out of the program when it was running through some tests. Now, basically went back and did a bunch more tweaking of the CPU frequency. I had it at 3.9 at first. I dialed it back to 3.875, and then 3.85, and then 3.825. It is nice with the Ryzen. You can dial, you don't have to overclock in 100 megahertz increments. You can do 25 megahertz increments, which lets you get a little bit more granular with that. But eventually I decided to just test things one at a time, and I realized it was actually the GPU overclock that was causing the failures. But ultimately I ended up with a CPU overclock of 3.85 gigahertz, which is not too bad at all. I did that with a voltage positive offset of about plus 0.1 or maybe plus 0.106 or something like that. That ended up giving me voltage that was hitting about 1.35 to 1.37 volts. And then when I was running a stress test, it was maxing at 1.4. which is well within the range that you should expect when you're overclocking Ryzen. You just don't want to get past 1.425, of course. Now, CPU temperatures were a little high, and actually running at higher voltage, if I was going over 1.4, the CPU was getting well up above 80, 85 degrees, and you don't want to get too far above that, because if it hits 95 degrees, it's going to start to throttle. So that is why I dialed back from 3.9 that I was at originally, but honestly, since I discovered that the GPU was what was actually causing the instability, I could probably go back there and play with it a little bit more. But most of you guys should be able to hit 3.8 or 3.9 gigahertz, possibly even beyond that, depending on your specific CPU. And when I tested Cinebench with the 1600X at stock, I got 1172 was my score. When I tested the 1600 overclocked, I hit 1279. Actually, I hit 1284, and then I hit 1279, and I had a few other tests right in that range. But clearly, you can see that by overclocking a 1600, you can make it perform better than a 1600X would out of the box. Of course, you can overclock a 1600X too. There's nothing wrong with that. But just saying, I really like the bang for the buck you get with the 1600. Moving on though, for the memory overclock, I pretty much punched in directly that 2933 speed. I went into the timing sections and I took all the timings that are listed on the side of the memory and I basically upped them all by 1 point. So I went from 15 to 16 or from 16 to 17, loosening up the timings just a little bit, which might help stability in the long run. But honestly, I think my memory was just fine the whole time anyway. For my GPU overclock using the MSI Afterburner utility, I set plus 90 megahertz on the GPU, plus 140 on the memory. Power target was set to 120 and I did plus 15 points on the voltage setting. The fans I manually set to 50%. Again, that was when I was trying to determine what was causing the issue. That resulted in a peak GPU frequency of about 2100 megahertz, which is a little high. It would taper off pretty quickly after that. It would end up running at 2080 max, and then it would dip down to around 2000 when it was actually under long-term stress test load. Temperatures. With all of these overclocks in place, it is May now, I should point out, here in Southern California, so my ambients are a little bit higher. It's about 80 to 85 degrees Fahrenheit here, which is 27 to 30 degrees Celsius, so bear that in mind. CPU temps were 37 degrees Celsius idle, about 70 to 80 degrees Celsius while gaming, and then during the stress test, it was hitting about 87 degrees Celsius max. GPU was at 38 degrees Celsius idle, 72C while gaming, and 81C during the stress test. Next up, I have some noise testing. So for comparison, here's what the system sounds like while at idle. Next up is a gaming test. Here's what the system sounds like while just running Unigine Valley. And finally, here's the full bore CPU and GPU stress test with Ida 64 and Unigine Valley. So obviously this isn't the quietest system ever. That is one of the trade-offs that you get by going with the stock heatsink fan versus something aftermarket, but it does get the job done. It's still allowing for some overclocking, and it's not the most terribly difficult thing to swap out in the future if you decide that you want to quiet things down just a little bit. Let's move into some benchmarks though, gaming benchmarks that is. I ran all of these at 2560 by 1440. I find that's a good resolution for a system like this. And I'm gonna do some comparisons here because last month I built a $1,400 Ryzen 7 system, and I kind of wanted to see how these lined up. So here's the comparison of my $1,000 build from this month compared to my $1,400 build from last month. So if you're just looking at those gaming benchmarks, the R5 1600 is pretty much neck and neck with the R7 1700, the 8-core chip that I tested last month, and that is pretty nice to know that if all you're focused on is gaming, you can still get very nice performance and you don't necessarily have to pay for a R7 chip. Of course, the fact that this is a 6-core part versus an 8-core part means that scores in Cinebench were definitely lower, and then the games that tested the CPU specifically, like the 3DMark tests, you saw lower scores in the physics and CPU-focused tests as well. Gaming tests, again, were pretty much even. There was a bit of a fluctuation here and there. Like, for instance, in the Overwatch test, the R5 system actually performed much better, but I would attribute that to updated drivers, since I am using a newer driver now than what was available about a month and a half ago when I tested the other system. So $1,000 freaking, awesome system, great for gaming, and hey, it's a 6-core, 12-thread chip again, so productivity I would easily recommend this for as well, whether you're doing video editing, or probably a really, really nice setup for somebody who's doing, like, streaming on Twitch or something like that, because you can play the game and also get extra cores and extra threads on the CPU to handle encoding and actually sending your data out to Twitch. while you're doing the streaming thing. So guys, if you enjoyed this video, then definitely hit the thumbs up button and let me know. Of course, comments in the comment section are always welcome as well, whether you're arguing the merits of this build or whether you have ideas for a build of your own. Anyway guys, thanks again so much for watching, and we'll see you next time.